some of the basic things that we have done for today's workshop. Friends, as you know that the renal diets are something that when, as ma'am has rightly pointed out, that when we plan it as per the regional and the ethnic food that the person is taking, it becomes very good. But just to give you a brief about all the presentations that you're going to see from the various regions, you have to understand, we have taken a standard reference patient who's going to be weighing 60 kilos, has a height of male, who has a height of 160 centimeter. This is the BMI. And basically, because we wanted to make a standard, we have taken it as normal electrolytes, having a high creatinine and a BP of 120 by 80. Normally, you will see these all these regional diets would be giving a calorie intake of 30 to 35 kilocalorie, and the proteins would be calculated in all these regional diets at about 0.6 to 0.8. Sodium and potassium is going to be within the range of 40 to 60 milliequivalents. Fluid is going to be normal, and the phosphorus is between 800 to 1000 milligrams. So I request my first team member to highlight the Goan cuisine. So over to you, Eileen.
Thank you, Zamrud, and I hope I'm clear. Very well said that when we are planning for this particular patient, we know that the patient here is not in an acute electrolyte disturbance phase. So there are things that come to a dietitian's mind when she looks at these parameters and levels. And for that sake, if you look at the range of the prescription that is given, which you can see towards the right of this slide, which says that calories is around 30 kilocalories. Now, when you reach to a goal of calories, which is 30 kilocalories, is after you have done the nutritional assessment of the patient. So when a dietitian does a professional nutritional assessment, she realizes how much of calories this patient requires. If the patient is in a protein energy wasting situation, that's when we take a decision for a higher caloric intake. Similarly, for the proteins, we look at various other aspects. And if we decide that this patient is going to get between 0.6 and 0.8, it will be around 45 to 48 grams of proteins for this patient. Now, here we look at other aspects of the diet prescription, that is your carbohydrates, fats, which if you look at this diet prescription, there is a little higher amount of fats compared to the other diets. And the reason is that we do require a little more fats for the calories, for other aspects, because we are also compromising on the protein intake. So in order to reach the calorie goal, we have to add some amount of fats to this diet. Sodium values is a range. Now, 40 to 60 milliequivalents is not a very small range, because even if you add half a teaspoon of salt to your diet, you have already achieved your almost 40 milliequivalents. So then what happens to the sodium for the food? Now, if you take sodium from food to less than 500, then you at least will reach to around 50 milliequivalents. Now, the decision for sodium will depend upon two aspects. One is the fluid intake, and the second is edema, and the third is blood pressure. The dietitian will look at all the three aspects before she takes a decision of how much of sodium to be given. Similarly for the potassium. Now, if you look at this Goan Western menu, there are various aspects in this menu which has been included, which are more or less on the side of a easy potassium. So if I look at the breakfast, we'll start with a bruschetta wrap, or if it's a traditional person who wants to eat a shipachi poli, that is the dill poli, which is traditionally made with urad dal and dill leaves. Now, if we have to restrict potassium for this patient, we will remove the dill leaves and we will ask the patient to have it without the green leafy vegetables. Similarly, the fruit choice, which is given in the mid-morning, can depend upon how much of fruit the person is eating. Now, lunch would contain things like risotto or chicken or kidney beans. Now, traditionally, when we look at the diets, when we restrict potassium, a lot of these things get out of the diet. But if we count the quantity and how much has to be given, we can add a little bit of pulses or non-veg foods to these diets and account for it, whether it is a fish curry or it is a little bit of coconut added to this. Similarly, the forbidden fruit, of renal patient food, that is the nuts and seeds, which we can look at adding a little bit when we are more or less free to use potassium levels. So this is more or less, I come to an end of the Goan Western cuisine. I hand it over to the next cuisine.
Yes, so the next cuisine that we are going to be talking is about the Maharashtrian cuisine, and we have Ms. Jayashree with us. So Jayashree, you can take over, please. Jayashree is there?
Sorry, I was muted.
Okay.
Yeah. Please. Anyways, good morning, and thank you, Zamrud, for this opportunity. I will not waste any more time, and I will straight away go to present my menu. Now, when we are talking about Maharashtrian menu, the special characteristics of Maharashtrian menu is availability of different grains and variety, which are used in savory as well as sweet dishes. Also, use of coconut milk and rice in different regions. That is a mainstay of Maharashtrian cuisine. Now, all these three products can be used in savory as well as sweet dishes. Now, coming to milk, we will talk about each of these ingredients. When we talk of milk, which provides source of first-class protein, even in vegetarian diets, and it can be used in liquid as well as in solid form. So, if patient is on fluid restriction, we can still make use of milk in these products. Also, when we are talking about rice is a choice of grain always because it is low in potassium, it is low in phosphorus, and it can also be used in savory dishes. It can be used in sweet dishes. It can be incorporated in variety of ways. Also, whether to use coconut or not, because coconut is a mainstay of Maharashtrian cuisine. Now, normally we think potassium content of coconut is high, so whether to incorporate or not. But if we are calculating the potassium coming from the diet, and if it fits the desired range of 40 to 60 milliliters, which is the case, which is given to us today, we can still smartly make use of coconut in the diet and still make the recipe palatable and which is familiar to the patient. And mainly, use of coconut can add density to our menu. And in many parts of Maharashtra, wheat flour is the choice of grain. Now, when if we want to use wheat flour, what we can do is hyperphosphatemia also is often seen in patients with CKD, where wheat product like maida and rava can be used to make different recipes. So having said this, let me talk about the menu which I am given. For now, since here we do not have a fluid restriction, I'm not talking about fluid restriction. For breakfast, we can give tea, which is light tea, which is not very brewed, because we also still have to keep check on the amount of potassium that we are giving. And along with that, we can include something like kanda poha or thali peet, which is mixture of different grain flour. Also, someone who is vegetarian can have milk or curd as source of protein, and who is non-vegetarian can have incorporate egg in their diet. Lunch can be made using rice bhakri as source of cereal. Vegetable, lentil can be in the form of varan or amti, and yogurt to include, again, as I said, first-class protein, which can be given as in the form of raita if we have fluid restriction. Evening, to make a calorie-dense snack, we can use something like sabudana vada, or we can give shrikhand and puri. Dinner can be similar. You can see, I will not waste time reading out my menu. So basically, what I'm trying to say is that using all these different kind of grains and this, you can still make the menu and the cuisine which is familiar to patient. It is palatable and enjoyed by CKD patients. Thank you.
Thank you, Jayashree. So our next cuisine from the West is the Gujarati menu, and I request Reema to please come ahead and present this Gujarati menu. Reema, you're muted. Yeah.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for this wonderful opportunity. And as the basic nutrient requirements are already explained by Zamrud and Aileen, I'll be discussing the nuances of a Gujarati meal. Despite having an extensive coastline providing wholesome seafood, Gujarat is primarily a vegetarian state. Many communities, however, do include seafood, chicken, and mutton in their diet, but due to the changing religious ideologies, Gujarat is turning into more and more a vegetarian state. And as you all know, the thali, the Gujarati thali is a very popular concept. The Gujaratis like to have all their food items together at the same time. So a typical Gujarati thali would consist of rotli, fulka roti, which is very thin and small, dal or kadi, rice and sabji, along with the preparations made from pulses or whole beans, a savory item which is known as farsan, and a sweet is a must for to be there in all the Gujarati thalis. So even at home, they do follow this practice. Buttermilk is again a must. And there are accompanies, especially the pickle tray is a very, it's a compulsory thing in a Gujarati household where they have different chutneys and pickles and papad. But we need to be very careful about this, especially for a Gujarati patient. A patient. So all these items, they are eaten together in the thali, and Gujarat is probably the only state where the sweet, the mithai, is taken almost at the beginning of the meal. There's also a lot of fasting and feasting both happening amongst the Gujaratis. So the Gujaratis are more adaptable to eating the so-called farali food also. So here I have tried to add arrowroot flour and sava millet, which the Gujaratis very easily have. They also have lot of sago, and farsan, which is made, is also steamed and eaten. So these are some of the the positives of a Gujarati diet, where the farsans are eaten, which is made up of besan. But here we can replace the besan with any farali flour, that is potato flour, arrowroot flour, or sago, and it is equally acceptable. So that is the best part about it. And the cooking method, which can be tweaked a little, instead of deep frying, the farsan could be steamed and then sauteed. So here you can see in my menu, morning then usually have khakra or bhakri, and this could be changed with poha or sama upma or makai handwa also, with a little bit of green chutney. Pudla is a very popular dish of Gujaratis. The mid-morning could be one fruit, seasonal fruit. Again, lunch will have fulka rotis. I've written 5 to 6 because the Gujarati rotis are really very small and very thin. Yogurt, the dahi or the buttermilk is a must. But fortunately, if the Gujarati person wants to have a khir, which is made up of milk, and where there is this thing about the phosphorus content, we normally they don't eat dahi if they eat a kheer, and if and vice versa, so that problem doesn't exist. Also, the evening sago vada or a sago patis could be given, steamed muttia could be given. The dinner would consist typically of thepla or bajra rotla or a juwar rotla with khichdi, vegetables, a sambhara kind of a thing, and again a little bit of buttermilk if there is no fluid restriction. Also, in between snack, a roasted poha can be used. So I will just tell you that with Gujaratis, there is a there are two main drawbacks. They use a lot of baking soda and they use a lot of mukwas. Now, the mukwas has got hidden sugars and salt, and also they are made up of all high potassium things, seeds and fennel seeds and other things. So they need to be careful about these two things particularly. Thank you so much.